this session with a very interesting set of discussants and our session chair. I would like to invite Dr. Arvind Kumar Padhee as the session chair for the second panel. Dr. Padhee is the Director of Country Relations and Business Affairs, New Delhi for ICRISAT. Dr. Padhee joined the Indian Administrative Services in 1996 and was recently included as a member of the National Advisory Panel on Agricultural Nutrition under Poshan Abhiyan. He regularly writes popular articles and op-eds regarding agriculture and food policies, climate change and rural development. Dr. Padhee will lead this session, and can I please ask you to invite the other panelists? Thank you very much.
I'm doing your job. Thank you. I invite Mr. Sanjay Puri. He is the President of the Rural Flour Fields Association of India. Welcome, Mr. Puri. Dr. Hari Sudini, my ICRISAT colleague, he is the Principal Scientist on Groundnut Pathology in ICRISAT. Mr. Ravinder, Giri, he is the Project Manager in HarvestPlus. Welcome. Ms. Pragya Nehru, she is the Deputy Director of Food and Agriculture in the CII. Welcome, Pragyanji. And Mr. Amrendra Mishra, Managing Director of Oilseeds at ADM India here in Delhi or Gurgaon. Please come. Adjust your chair. Friends, we have a very informed audience here, so we would not go into the basics, nor I would like to repeat something which has already been discussed. We'll be very brief, but I would like to request the discussants to confine to their domain and also speak something on the Indian perspective. All of us are here. We have already heard about the global best practices, the research evidences and other stuff. I would just request them to confine to their domain so that it will be more interesting and kind of easy for us to follow. I will also not do any number crunching from now on. First thing, because food crops are seasonally produced, but they are consumed throughout the year, that's how the grain storage is very important. We may be producing in one season in a particular place, but we have to consume the rice or wheat or any other pulse crop, other stuff throughout the year. That's how the importance of grain storage comes. But then I would like to go again with my previous chair, Dr. Bob Ziegler, when he says that we are not talking about the high-end technology. We would also talk about the improved storage systems. So we will confine to the improved storage systems. I would very humbly request my panelists to kindly confine into anything that kind of talks about the improved storage systems. Here I can just, I just came across a figure where it says about 60-70% of the food grains produced in India is estimated to be stored in conventional structures, not in the very high-end the technologies that we discussed in the previous panel. We heard about the most recent techniques of the hermetic metal silos or the multi-layer bagging systems, the using the air tightness to maintain the hermetic conditions. I just find to adopt this kind of technologies, there are two very simple commonsensical constraints. One is the initial investment costs, because one would not, a farmer, smallholder farmer, may not be having that much of money to buy. And the second one is the complexity of technology. It may not be very simple to everybody. We just came across an evidence from Bihar, where if there could be some subsidy, maybe the adoption could be more in the later period. Then what could be the criteria or what could be the solutions for this? We have to inform the farmer or the smallholder or anybody storing the grains to have effective storage conditions of the grain, because the temperature, the relative humidity, the moisture in the grain when it is harvested, the time of the harvest, everything matters to the farmer. How could we pass on such information to the farmers would make a very big difference. And all these storage structures, or whether it is a bag, hermetic bag, it has to be available locally. I mean, the local availability would also decide about the adoption. And if it is a beef, then the ease of handling, I mean, well, it should fit. In many areas, I have the privilege of working in very interior pockets as a district collector, and I have seen many of the tribals and many of the smallholders in many rural pockets, they would place the bin inside their home. I mean, they do not have any enough place to also put these structures somewhere else. And how could they, the ease of moving it from one place to the other also would make. On the chemical side, when we are talking about the chemical management of the stored grains, there are three very immediate concerns that comes to my mind. I have a background in the agriculture science, so I know the basics of it. The resistance problem to pesticides when we use it, whether it is the delta method, the pyrethroid compounds, or even the other simpler chemicals like malathion and others. So the resistance to the pesticides is one issue. Number two issue in India is the spurious characteristic of our pesticides. Even if somebody is using the pesticide, one may not be very sure that he or she is using the right chemical. The adulteration is also an important consideration there. And obviously the associated environmental and the health related concerns are there. These are the stuff that I wish to make in the beginning. I would like to begin with Mr. Sanjay Puri. He is the president of the Flour Millers Federation of India. So you have been associated in this sector, and of course wheat is a a flour is a commodity which is consumed by all sections of the society. Now it has already penetrated down south. So what is your perspective, and how do you visualize this problem, and how do you find solutions to the constraints that I just mentioned?
Thank you very much, Mr. Padhee, and I would also like to thank the audience here. Well, let me start with the fact that the flour mill Federation has been representing the flour millers in this country since 1940. So we've been there from the time it was pre-partition. 42, if you remember, was the time of massive famine in this country. So from that time to the time of plenty now, as we see, there's been quite a big transition. And to give an answer to the kind of situation we have in this country, when I came here, I thought I would learn something about the new technology. Yes, maybe people do talk about technology and just bags. But we have a population of more than a billion now in this country, and wheat crop is going to be about 100 plus million tons this year. Total grain is about 248 million, and the horticulture produces 311 million tons. Now, I have to tell you that you may have solutions, but what I feel is the ingenuity of our country in handling this kind of wheat and storing the wheat, the rice, the food grain is incomparable. There is nothing that can beat the Indian jugaad or the Indian ingenuity in trying to keep the system in the times where we need to handle it in bags. Now, we have by force maintained a system in this country where we understand this is wrong. But it goes on. So there is where Bob was talking about who is the person who benefits out of that. So they cannot be that nobody benefits out of this, we don't know about it. We know about it. You people are very, very smart people here. But I can tell you that the smartest people, much, much smarter than you, are people sitting outside who devise these policies. There's an order which tells me that the food corporation has to store 80 to 90% of their food grain in jute bags. Are you aware of the fact that they buy jute bags at over 90 rupees a bag? You're talking about hermetically sealed bags being expensive. These people are buying 90 rupees a bag. So how do they manage it? Where are the funds coming in for that? The farmer is pretty smart actually. He's not a bad guy. He brings his produce to the mandis open in lorries. Nobody brings it in bags. They don't want to bring it in bags. They understand that bags are useless. So they bring it in the lorry and they dump it onto the ground. It is the government of the food corporation that makes sure that it is put into the bag. Similarly, all our imports come in loose bulk. The much better way is to handle the wheat and the grain than to put them in the bags. Where is the need for a bag? Now, if somebody tells me nobody benefits out of that, I mean, I don't need to be a, you know. So we have had meetings with the food secretary, and I said, sir, give me at least one benefit before you leave this office. And that was Sudhir Kumarthi, very honest, very, very diligent, very smart food secretary. And I would meet him, and he would, you know, listen to us, connect with us. I said, sir, give us storage silos. He says, do you think that will solve the problem? Now, I'll tell you what happened to the silos. The Adanis built up silos in Amritsar, and they built it up in Moga and places around Punjab. And nobody buys the wheat from the silos. I don't want the wheat from the silos. Because who's doing the aspiration then? They put the wheat into the silos, and the wheat rotted. It heated up. So it's not such a simple answer. Where is the concern? When you have a public sector handling such a big crop, I thought they would be the people who do model, you know, ways of handling it, and we would learn from them. I don't know. They're talking about moisture. You know, somebody said that if you bring down the moisture, and these people from Bangladesh who've got this technology to reduce the moisture in the crop. We have wheat storages in Punjab where we have the technology, and we have pipelines and wells, bore wells in the storage ground. Every time a rake is loaded to the next wheat depot in FCI, there's a sprinkling there. They actually increase the moisture percentage. Nothing happens to the wheat. We're very smart. We know how to handle wheat at a higher moisture percentage without damaging it. And now we have the biggest store of wheat possibly in the history of mankind. And we're not talking about hoarding now. And he's right. You know, Vijay, his presentation here was something I really was impressed with, because NCDX has given a lot of solutions to the government. Now, where does this start? Who wants to, first of all, tell me, when you have the kind of storage you have in this country, who in the world would want to store wheat? You talk about industrialists want to store wheat in a godown. Forget it. Nobody wants to store wheat, or rice for that matter. Why would I want to store wheat when there's a bomb of wheat stocks out there, and government has got no idea what to do with it, other than sell it at 2 rupees a kilo in the PDS? So maybe there was somebody there who has to decide the policy. So who's benefiting? I don't know. But the storage and the solutions you gave here are the solutions which are just the very, very, very smart solutions. But are we even looking at that part of the story? We need to do bulk storages. We are much more comfortable. We don't want your gunny bags. We have to sell them. We have to recycle them. I know that. Somebody needs to do a study and finding out that if the entire jute industry goes away, how much money you want to give to them? Because they're holding it to ransom. They're holding the country to ransom. And we need to find a reason for the people to store in a proper manner. First of all, store. And next year, I want to know why somebody would even want to grow wheat. Because we've got so much of it, and we don't know what to do with it. So I think I'll stop at this, and maybe
we'll just take from there and get back to you again on a small point. You talked about the hoarding. Many experts like Professor Gulati and many others are suggesting to do away with the essential commodities act, to do away with the stock holding limits and other stuff. So you need not confine it to wheat alone. Do you see any point?
No, the point is that it's a very interesting sport. It works depending upon how you want to play it. So we got a complaint this time from two agencies. One was the Food Corporation of India, which was saying the people are not lifting enough wheat in the market, and therefore we have to lift it, and we don't have the storage space, and that's why we want to keep the OMS's prices so high. And then we had the millers in UP who came up to me. They said the government is not allowing us to buy the wheat from the farmer. Now, where's the answer to this? I can give you an answer if you want, but let's continue. It's a very, very tricky answer to this. And then there is of course Punjab and Haryana, who don't give a damn about anything other than collecting 8% to 7% taxes on that. So FCI ke ilawa, wahan pe nobody will ever buy any wheat from there. So we will continue to have the storage situation there. So you're talking about, sir, it's a very complex situation. Whether you want that law there or not is not whether it's a logical law or whether it makes any benefit. Like Bob said, there is somebody who's benefiting out of that.
Thank you. Very broad answer, but you confine your answers to wheat as a commodity, but I wanted it to be in a broader spectrum. I switch over to Pragya now. You have to give me the industry perspective as to how do you view these storage problems and what are the solutions that you suggest.
I think there are many So I think we have heard from a lot of industry already giving their perspective, and the perspective is quite different. I mean, if I talk about the what Mr. Sanjay Puri has just talked, and before that what Sanjeev Asthana was talking, from a CII and from a food and agriculture perspective, what we foresee is that when we are talking about a storage, a grain storage, and we are talking about how the farmer is benefiting, is it necessary to provide a storage to each and every farmer? Then, you know, then another thought that comes to our mind is, why can't we look at a community storage at village level? It's basically an aggregation point where the farmers are coming, storing their produce, and then you need to link it to a streamlined, you know, integrated supply chain, taking logistics into account, so that the farmer also sees a benefit. Okay, if I'm storing it, then it will move to some place. For a farmer, just storing it and don't know what to do with it won't result into anything. So, you know, from the private sector, it's also that you streamline the entire supply chain when we are talking about the procuring, the storing and the distribution together. This could be done in a PPP or a quasi-PPP or through government interventions. I mean, that is something that can be looked at.
I come to Dr. Hari Sudini, my ICRISAT colleague. Hari, you have been involved in the pre- and post-harvest aflatoxin management in our institute, particularly in Groundnut, and I am personally aware about your activities in the Odisha project of analytic bags. Could you please elaborate the project also, your research activities as well?
Thank you. So, as Dr. Padhee mentioned, I represent ICRISAT, and there is no introduction needed for ICRISAT. Actually, most of you or all of you might be knowing that ICRISAT is one of the CG centers like IFPRI and Giri. So, we at ICRISAT actually work on 6 mandate crops. Groundnut, chickpea and pigeon pea are the 3 legumes, and sorghum, bajra and finger millet are the millets on which we work on. So I exclusively work on groundnut, and my interest is groundnut pathology. So storage is very important issue in the case of groundnut, and I exclusively work on groundnut storage too actually. So the 2 most important issues in groundnut storage is aflatoxin contamination. If you store your groundnuts under improper conditions and any re-wetting from the environment, and that could lead to the mold infestations and thereby aflatoxin accumulation. And another important issue in groundnut storage is the crucid insect pest, which is very voracious pest, and even 1 or 2 crickets in one bag can multiply phenomenally in the next 2 to 3 months, and it can cause at least 20 to 30% damage within a span of 2 to 3 months. So these are the 2 major issues in the case of groundnut, with which most of the farmers, they are reluctant to store groundnut actually. So since morning we are talking about how best these hermetic storage technologies can help in grain storage. I'll go a step forward and I'll talk about seed systems, how these hermetic storage technologies can help improve informal seed systems. So I'll take groundnut as an example, because groundnut is a self-pollinated crop and farmers can save their own seed actually. There is no need to depend fresh seed every year, every season actually. So here exactly the government of Odisha came forward, because we at ICRISAT, in partnership with the Indian Council of Agriculture Research and State Agriculture Universities, we have been releasing many improved groundnut varieties, but when it comes to the adoption actually, most of these varieties are not in the hands of the farmers. The reason is, we are giving a quality seed in one season. By the time they harvest, they are selling it off in the market, and again for the next season they come forward and give me the seed. So it is a very Herculean task for the public agencies or for the government, for anybody, to produce groundnut in huge quantities and supply seed for the farmers, because the seed rate is very high in the case of groundnut. Each farmer for 1 acre needs 60 to 80 kg of groundnut seed. So it is almost a very difficult task for the government agencies to produce that much quantities of seed and produce on subsidy basis every year, every season. It's a big exchequer for the government, state governments especially. So exactly here, the government of Odisha came forward and said, okay, so you have the hermetic storage technologies, and you have the evidence too that they are working very well for the storage of groundnut. for the storage of groundnut seed too. So why don't you implement a project in the state of Odisha so that you can strengthen the informal seed systems in Odisha, wherein the government can reduce its exchequer on the subsidies. So last year we have given 50,000 bags. The government has formulated a scheme, actually a state level scheme, wherein the government is giving 90% subsidy the bag. Actually, for example, the bag cost is 100 rupees. The government of Odisha is collecting only 10 rupees per bag from the farmer, and 90 rupees the government is bearing. So only 10 rupees the farmer has to pay. So 25,000 farmers the government of Odisha selected, and we distributed 50,000 bags to 25,000 farmers, and we asked them, we have conducted extensive capacity building programs, how to use the bag, how to store actually when you want to store your groundnuts, what is the moisture content with which you have to keep it inside the bag and all those things, how to tie the bag and all the capacity building activities we have taken up, and we encouraged them to save their own seed actually. So with the result, after the first year, 50,000 bags, they could able to store 2,000 tons of groundnut seed, 2,000 tons. So the government has to give a subsidy for each acre on 60 to 80 kg. That means the government has to spend 2,000 to 3,000 anywhere in between for each farmer. But here in this case, just 180 rupees for each farmer the government has spent. Just gave two bags and encouraged them to save their own seed. And they could have saved a lot of exchequer on the subsidies of groundnut seed. This is one of the best example of cost-benefit ratio. Since this morning we are talking about cost-benefit ratio, and Professor Gulati was also asking about what is the cost-benefit ratio. Here the government is reducing a lot of exchequer, especially by encouraging them to use hermetic storage technologies to store their own seed. This is one of the best example in the state of Odisha. And again this year, we'll be distributing another 50,000 bags, and again we will be giving to another 25,000 bags, and we are encouraging them to store their own seed actually. So another important advantage is whenever we promote a good variety, so the variety seed will be with the farmer actually, it's not going to be lost actually. So they can save their own seed, and that's how the improved varieties can, the adoption of improved varieties can be increased. This is one of the another best example by promoting hermetic storage technologies. So this is actually when you look at grain versus seed storage, the value when you store seed is much more compared to the grain storage when you use hermetic storage technologies. But the only one important thing here one has to concentrate is each seed behaves differently under hermetic storage environment. It could be germinability and it could be seed vigor. So that has to be researched actually, each and every seed, how it behaves in 3 months time, in 6 months time, in 9 months time, has to be researched thoroughly, and then only we can promote these kind of hermetic storage technologies, especially for self-pollinated crop seed storage, and that will add a lot of value, and even the government can also reduce their exchequer on providing subsidies on seed.
And just a clarification, because in Odisha, groundnut is raised in both of seasons,
yes,
in Kharif, in the western Odisha, and in the Rabi, in the coastal districts of Odisha. So is it confined to one season and parts of the state? Or
no, actually this project is confined to the Rabi season actually. Whatever the harvest comes from the Rabi, and again we are encouraging them to store for until the next Rabi season.
My advice would be, because I having worked in the state, I was the director and commissioner of the department. So my suggestion would be that if we could also store in a dehumidifier or in this kind of a storage bag for the other part of the state, that could be used as the seed material in the Rabi, in the coastal district, or maybe in the next season. That would be useful. Thank you so much. It's a very good research product going to the field for the welfare of the farmers. And you also brought out the fact that it is not very heavily subsidized. When Hari told that it is 90% subsidy, it is only on the bags, not on the other parameters. Now I turn to Mr. Ravinder Giri. You are the project manager of HarvestPlus. When HarvestPlus comes, we talk about the nutrition, the hidden hunger and the biofortification exercises. What do you say about this grain storage and the storage system?
Thank you, Dr. Padhee. So, after an aggressive discussion from Sanjay Puri, it is really difficult to, say why the storage is needed. So, he clarified that no storage is needed at all. But you know, for the from the farmer's perspective, right? So at least I'm not saying that for the commercial point of view. So it considers both commercial as well as his consumption as well. So the storage is needed for the smallholder farmers because, as you know, the Padhee has also said. So HarvestPlus is working with a mission of a world free of hidden hunger, and we are working it through the biofortified crops, the crops which are rich in micronutrients. So our focus or our aim is to give the biofortified crops to the farmer, and we promote or we suggest them to save those seeds for the next season and save those seeds at least for consumption during whole year. So, and these two things are impossible without a proper storage. And there are lots of challenges at the farmer's point of view or at the farmer's field. So why, you know, this scientific storage is needed there. So I will give you, you know, a brief, you know, some of the challenges which our partners are sharing, because we are working for these crops or, you know, the channel partners for this project. And they usually, you know, have to store their produce, and what they are suggesting or what the challenges really are there at the ground level, that I will discuss with you. So, you know, we know, and we since morning we are saying that grain moisture is really very important, or it will be topmost priority for this. And the grain moisture, it can, you know, when it is the produce is coming from the field, it should be checked at that particular point. Right. That's the best possible place where it should be marked or it should be checked. But at the farmer's field, there is no, you know, say the facility with them to dry their produce. Right. So at the time of harvest, everybody is in a hurry. Right. You want to harvest his crop, you want to send it to the ultimate purchaser so that he can get the money. But they don't have the basic facility of drying that particular produce. So that is the biggest challenge, and I think we need to develop some drying system at the farmer's level. Then we are saying the storage space is the second limitation for them. Farmers do not have any storage space particularly, or they can't store the produce for a month or two. So at least because this is required, so at the main season, so there are, you know, third party vendors or the you know, middlemen are there, right? Who go to the farmer and they take their produce and they say that you sell it at a lower price, I will take care of everything. I will take care of your transportation, I will take care of storage. So that margin farmer is losing. So in order to save that particular margin, at least the farmer is not getting the MSP, the produce. So for that purpose, the minimum storage space should be there with the farmers in order to store that particular produce for them. And then, for eating purpose, this was a commercial point of view, but for a eating purpose also, he is not having a proper storage facility. Because if you know that in India, overall, the traditional storage is, you know, farmers storing their produce inside their houses. One room, at least, or they have, you know, marketed one room that they will store their produce in that particular room. But looking into the population, right? So now, every family has, you know, that many people that it cannot spare one empty room for only for the seed storage. So then what they are doing? They are selling all their produce into the market, and then they go back to the market and purchase it for their food. They are losing when they are selling, and they are getting that same produce at a higher price. So that's another challenge which farmers is, you know, facing. So that is the other point which I just wanted to. And then, you know, if farmer means storing their produce during the season, or at least for a month or two, that I was saying. So if we provide that farmer with some handy gadgets, right? So farmer can purchase you know, any gadget which is, you know, a very minimal range of price, or at least for taking the moisture content of their produce, or take the temperature of the grain storage system, something like that. That will really help. That will really help him to store it, you know, at standard conditions. Then, you know, improper pest control is be another thing which farmer or our partners are dealing, or they are saying that there's something at that particular front. So these are, you know, the education at that particular point of level is also required for them. Dr. Jha in the morning has said that, you know, in order to upgrade the storage, the traditional storage system, so the Bihar government is providing subsidized bin systems. So that is really a good initiative from the state governments, which are, you know, promoting those. But in Bihar, because we are working across Bihar, and then the penetration of that storage system is very less. Farmer is still struggling with that. So there are, you know, these are the major challenges which our partners or the farmer at its level is facing. So we need to, you know, consider these. So while we are suggesting them this way of storage or the how they can store the produce.
Thank you, Ravinder, for speaking for the smallholder farmer. When it comes to agriculture, we always talk about Haryana, Punjab, rice, the political crops of rice and wheat. So we often tend to forget the smallholder farmers and also the other crops. Now I talk to Mr. Amrendra Mishra, he's the MD, all seats of the ADM India company. So ADM Institute is the host for this particular program. So Amrendra ji, would you please tell your thoughts on this?
Yeah, sure. Thanks for introducing me. So I represent Archer Dairies Midland, ADM in India. And our business in India is primarily oilseeds processing. So we have processing plants in the state of Maharashtra and Karnataka. And as being part of ADM, we are culturally, we are very close to the farmers. So in India also, we have developed the network of the farmers where we work very closely with the farmers and right from the planting till the harvest, and then as a processor, we are originating the raw materials from the farmers for our plants. So the quality of the raw material which the farmers are supplying to us definitely matters a lot, and hence our association from the farmer starts from the planting. And then at the time of harvest, where we educate the farmers a lot, where that how they have to harvest, where they have to keep their produce, what are the storage solutions that are available to them. So we also have silos, scientifically built silos that are processing plants, where we offer space to the farmers, and then they can store their product and then price it later. So I think. What we are talking about, just about the storage, but what I look from is the entire ecosystem where the farmer is thinking about his economics of generating the revenue from the crop. So there are points in our area we have seen that the farmers, they just cut their beans and pile up in their field, forget about thrashing at that time, because the priority for them is to plant the other crop because of the less moisture availability. Secondly, the labor is costly. They also look for the other crop that they can harvest after 2-3 months. So on economies of scale, the farmer is better off threshing two crops together rather than just soybean crops. So all those factors come in play. Now you can imagine that here we are talking about storage, and there in reality the crop is there, heaped in the ground, which is like exposed to sun or rain or whatever, and then what is does to the quality. So in reality, there are a lot of pieces which are floating around and which needs to be seen. Then during storage, like as some of the members pointed out, the least costly option for a farmer is put his beans in a fertilizer bag and put it in his backyard. I mean, that's the cheapest solution. And we have very small farmers. They cannot afford to take every time their beans or wheat or whatever to a warehouse and put it in a scientific storage. It's too costly. Unless and until you have an aggregator who is aggregating the produce so that the cost per ton for the farmers goes down, and then they start seeing the value of the system. So as Vijay in the previous panel pointed out, that aggregator model is something which we need to look into the Indian farming because of the small size of our farmers. We are not talking about US or Brazilian farmers where they are all in their Semi-Arid to be able. So this is a totally very, very fragmented setup. Then then finally talking about this, the quality during the storage. That is one of the aspects where the farmers are going to make money. If you look at this year's harvest, it has been a very wet harvest with the monsoons. It's kept on raining till end of October. So unless the farmer is not taking good care of their grains, they are cleaning it properly, drying it properly, and storing it properly, they are going to get dogged on their the quality aspects by the processors. So I think from the point of view of the farmers or industry, when we are talking, we need to take the entire value chain into the system and see that how we can generate more value with the farmers towards a better storage practices. Thanks.
Just digressing from the grain storage, because you represent the CII, and we were informed that for the last couple of years, at least 3 years, the agricultural production has surpassed the food grains production in our country. Could you tell something about the agri-logistics, the cold chain and other stuff for the fruits and vegetable sector? Just though it is, we are talking about the grain storage, we'd like to know about the CII industry perspective.
So when we talk about perishables, they are very different from when we start talking about the grains, because when we start talking about the perishables, every commodity is different. So when we talk about post-harvest, and especially post-harvest management and post-harvest protocols, for every commodity it is different. We cannot store apple in the same way in which we plan to store a tomato. And for horticulture, another point that we need to take into account, because of the perishability nature of an horticulture commodity, the best thing is to, as soon as the harvesting is done, the sooner we can move to the market and to a larger distance through a cold chain, through using need for transport and maintaining the cold chain from end to end, is something which will actually help in reducing the loss, which differs what is happening in the food grains. Yes.
Thank you so much. I just wanted to bring that into perspective. I have already read the minds of my panelists. I would not like to ask anything more. I would like to go to the traditional grain harvesting systems. From the audience, if any one of you is good at well informed and would like to inform this audience and the house, you can please speak about the traditional grain harvesting, grain storage structures. Anybody from the audience would enlighten the house on the traditional ones? We know the indigenous practices of putting neem leaves and other stuff in India. In India, in many, as I told you in the beginning, only 30 to 40% is into the scientific storage system. Rest 60 to 70% are through the traditional grain storage systems. Is anybody informed or would like to add here, or you are? Yes, please. You can speak from there.
Farmers, they are using father all safe seeds particularly for wheat. They use all the aluminium phosphide or other chemicals provided by the Department of Agriculture. These are not available in the market also. So it is prevalent largely in Punjab, Haryana, and West Indies. Totally, it's the only practice. Nobody uses them other method.
Chemical one. Phosphine is aluminium phosphide is the chemical fumigation method. I just wish to know if any one of you could tell us about the traditional or the indigenous grain storage systems in our country. Okay, we are all much advanced than the traditional stuff. But I have personally seen in many instances, they go for the mud walls and silos, and from the paddy straw they make it, and in many instances, I mean, I wish some empirical studies could be done there. They're equally kind of proof to this kind of attacks by the storage insects or other stuff. Yes, I'd be happy if you can say something.
Yeah, from the Bangladesh perspective, you know, the formal storage system is still actually at large. So most of the farmers, they are actually storing their own actually harvest. So usually after harvesting, they are selling almost 1/3 to make up their actually the costers, and 1/3 they actually store for 2 to 3 months, as because the next crop is coming in the 6 months time, and the other 1/3 they store at home for their own consumption. So still the farmers are using, you know, that in the morning session there was a picture, you know, there's the dough, laudi, these are the bamboo and as structures. They put it into it. Whenever you go into their houses, you will find the flies and the insects are actually moving from here to there. But in case of this seed storage, especially you know that we have usually the three cropping system, but two permanent cropping system. One is called Boru and another is called Amon. But in Amon system, that means the paddy is being harvested in November and December. So the farmers usually kept their seed. So these are the traditional actually storage of system. So they usually collect the seed actually from harvest the seed carefully, and then they actually thresh it and dry it properly, clean it properly. Then they put into the, you know, this earthen pot. So what the usual practice is still, sometimes they put some of this, you know, the candle in it and actually light it. So just get rid of this the oxygen in that and put, you know, there is a cover wood atom that's made of again the mud, and you actually the close it properly. And sometimes, as you mentioned, the neem leaves and other leaves they put inside it so that they can have out of the insects. So these are the usual practice still.
Mostly used for seed material, not yes. The grains.
Okay. And the grains, it is the open, you know, there's the big open bamboo structures and the footing,
and
it is open.
Seen, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Last, I would just like to close because the time is up, that we got some evidences coming from the ground that farmers do value these technologies, storage technologies which are being given. And I'm also of the opinion that initially if we could give some kind of support, incentives from the public sector, from the government, then it might sustain. I wish to thank all my panelists for a very good discussion. Thank you, everyone.